And I saw people marching around that building, covert. There was fighting going on, and gunshots, and people dying. Finally, the army gets inside that building and kills everyone in there. Then after that, the fighting dies down. But what struck me, it went down to my core, was when that building is destroyed or everyone inside is killed, I saw something like a demon rise up out of that building.
I've been able to partner with Mind Valley to present you guys free master classes between 60 and 90 minutes covering mind, body, soul, relationships, and conscious entrepreneurship, taught by spiritual masters, yogis, spiritual thought leaders, and best-selling authors. Just head over to nextlevelsoul.com/free. I'd like to welcome to the show, Ken Leth. How are you doing, Ken?
I'm doing great. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. You have a very interesting story to tell, and I am here to help you tell it to our audience. So, you had a near-death experience when you were 8, but it seems like you've been having interesting experiences even from the womb. So can you talk a little bit about those experiences before we get to your near-death experience?
Experiences from the womb. So, okay. Then you're referring to my earliest memories, mm-hmm. going back. Okay. Well, if you want it in a line of progression, I believe I lived a previous life before this one. Mm-hmm. I believe I lived in northern France. I recall going to a river where there was work being done, and I think we were harvesting some kind of reed or something. Along the river, and those reeds were used for like housing to like cover a roof, that kind of thing. I think I was a young man. Let's see. Something happened to me. It seems like I got sick, or I might have been in a fight of some kind. I'm not sure, but I remember people being really upset, and then I remember. Lying on the floor, it was dirt, but I had a bed of hay and I was sick, and there were some women coming and going from the hut that we lived in, really upset because they didn't know what to do with me. And then I remember just passing away. I floated, my consciousness floated above my body. I was floating in the room, and then I went through the roof, and then I was above the hut. And I could see down on the grass and stuff on the top of the roof. And then from there, I just went up and I saw a bright light, and then it ended. The very next thing I remember is I have like a guardian angel with me or some sort of entity talking to me. I'm up in heaven and I'm being confronted by a group of, I'll call them entities because I don't know what else, but some people have told me it sounds like a council of elders. Mm-hmm. So others have recounted that kind of thing, or they have a memory of that kind of thing. And these are like authority figures, and they're asking me questions about my experience on Earth and what do I remember and what did I learn, especially what did I learn. I got hung up on explaining to them what love was. And my guardian angel sort of whispered in my ear and said, you have to answer this question, but do it the best you can. If you don't really know the answer, just do the best you can. I don't recall exactly what I said, but it was determined that I hadn't learned enough. But it wasn't like a punishment. It was just they sent me back down to Earth and to this life now. So... But before I was sent down, my guardian angel took me away from the council of elders, took me kind of like outside a room, explained everything to me very well. And then he like opened up an opening from heaven or a tunnel So I can see down to earth. And this angel showed me a loving couple, a young couple in a living room down on earth. They're very much in love. And then I could feel the love between them. I could feel it. And the angel told me that we can send you down and you can be their next child. And you can experience love through them. So I thought it sounded all right. I mean, they were laughing a lot and having a great time. You know, I really enjoyed being around them. So yeah, I'll go with them, no problem. So I was sent down and then next memory is my birth. And now some people really poo-poo the idea that a person can have a memory of their own birth, but you have to remember, as I talk, you'll realize that when I was 8 years old, I had a near-death experience. I was shown my entire life, 8 years of it up in heaven. Part of that was I was shown my birth. So I think that's where the memory comes from. So the next line of progression is I'm being born on earth into this current life. And I'm cooperating with the natural movement of my mother's uterus and the muscles pushing me. And I'm working with it. I'm very aware that something important is going on, so I didn't fight it. And then all of a sudden, the pushing stopped. I was trapped in this very tight place, not like being loose in the uterus. I was, you know, I was being squeezed. The squeezing wouldn't stop. The movement stopped. Then my mother's heart slowed down. And I knew something was wrong. And even as an infant, right before I was born, I knew something was seriously wrong. And to save myself, I tried to back up. And then I left my infant body. And I was outside, my body floating around. And I took the form of just a brilliant orb of light. I was greeted by another orb of light, and I realized it was a girl. I had no idea who it was. I just knew it was a girl. And this girl said, come on with me. And she was older. And she took me, and then we started to fly around together. And it was fun. But eventually, I was told, and yet a third entity came. Another orb came to me and said, you need to be born. You need to go back to your body. And they sent me back into my body inside my mother. What I found out later in life was that my mother was overdosed on laughing gas during my birth. Our doctor was really old, and I was born in 1955. And the county hospital was actually a house. and the way I knew all this is because my mother never really told me about it until I was much older. And we went for a walk one night in my mother's hometown, and we stopped in front of this old house, and she goes, you don't know this, but you were born up in that room up there where that window is, you were born up there. And that's when she explained to me that was the county hospital. And she told me the doctor was really old. He screwed up. He loved to go hunting, and he knew that my father was a hunter and my dad was just outside in the next room waiting. He wanted to take a break and go talk to my dad, have a cigarette, you know? So he put the gas mask next to my mother's face on the table and he turned it on, but he didn't put it on her. He put it next to her and he told her, I'm going to go out and have a cigarette with your husband. So when you get in a lot of pain, just turn into the gas and breathe and then get away from it and everything's cool. So he takes a long break with my dad. When he comes back, the mask is on my mother's face and she's knocked out and she's getting this strong continuous dose of, I think it's nitrous oxide, laughing gas. It almost killed her. She had to be revived. That's why when I was an infant, I had a memory of her heartbeat almost stopping. That's what caused that.
So that's how you started this journey.
That's how it, yeah, with his life, that's how it started. Yeah. And I also found out much later in life, I was talking to my mother about it on her deathbed, you know, that was back in 2012. Come to find out, she carried a tremendous amount of guilt because of all that. She never really admitted it, but to me later, she told me that she always felt like I always acted a little bit goofy or a little bit retarded, and she felt it was because of her and the laughing gas. Wow. Now, can you imagine a grown man watching his mother die, and all of a sudden you find out your mother always thought you were just a little bit off? I mean,
that's a little messed up.
Thanks, Mom. You know,
bye, Mom. But, yeah. Thanks. I appreciate it.
But, you know, all the pieces to the puzzle fit then, because that explained all those times that when she protected me and told me to be quiet or kept me away from groups of people, I always didn't really understand why she was doing that. But I went along with it because I was her child. Well, she was embarrassed. She was afraid I'd say or do something that was embarrassing.
Right. That makes sense.
And so she always protected me. And then it had an effect on my personality, because then I was like, when I got a chance to break away and just be myself and do something, even if it was just weird, I would just do it, because I was tired of being stifled all the time.
Right.
But she, yeah, she carried a tremendous amount of guilt. And I think my dad did too.
So then, so what happened when you were 8 years old and you had your near death experience?
Well, I came home from school really sick one day. And I don't know, I was hungry though. We sat down to the dinner table, but I couldn't eat. My stomach got too weird. So it resembled the flu. And I remember a lot of vomiting. A lot of vomiting. I couldn't hold down water, juice, nothing for several days. I remember the vomiting at one point got so violent that my stomach was empty and I was vomiting bile. There's nothing else there. Mm-hmm. And bile burns something terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And then I couldn't drink water to get rid of it, the burning, because if I did, it just made me vomit more. So it was awful. So my parents, they called a local doctor. Mom always did kind of blame him for my getting sick, not realizing that I had an appendicitis. But I also know my mother, she had this thing about when she called somebody like a doctor or a priest or somebody, she might have a problem, but she would make it sound like, oh, it's not so bad. Mm-hmm. You know, she didn't want to bother people.
Right.
So my son is sick, but we think it's the flu, and the doctor went with it.
Of course.
Yeah. So they kept me at home. So I know that I was home for at least a week, if not longer. I was so sick, though, I'm not really sure. I have a good gauge of time. But and then my mother had a job. Dad, that week that I was taken to the hospital, Dad had to leave town with his job. So he was gone like a couple of days. And then my mother's boss called and begged her to come back to work. She'd been keeping an eye on me, but her boss was just desperate to get her to come in just for half a day. So she left me alone for like a morning, or maybe it was an afternoon. I can't remember. The vomiting had stopped, you know, so I just said, fine, go ahead. I wasn't scared. But I woke up from a really hard sleep, and I woke up so thirsty. I couldn't stand it. It was like dehydration kicked in while she was gone. So I somehow got to the kitchen sink. It wasn't too far away, and I took a drink of water. And I didn't get the whole thing down, and I passed out and fell down on the floor. And the whole room just went white. I remember laying there on the floor looking straight up, and all the color in my vision just faded to white, but it faded real slow. And then I felt this fuzzy, hazy feeling come over me. But I was conscious. And I just lay there and just, you know, watched it happen. And then eventually the color came back and I was like, well, I can't stay on this floor. I better get up. But I had to crawl on my hands and knees to get to the couch where I'd been sleeping. And when I got to the couch, it didn't feel right. There was something like out of place. And I kept turning and tossing and stretching. And then something in my gut kind of went boink. And I felt it. But you know, the instant that happened, I felt better. I was ready to get up and play. I felt so good. Mom came home and I told her about the whole incident, you know, passing out and everything. She got more worried than ever. I guess I didn't look very good. Mm-hmm. Looked really, really white. And she, I don't know why, but she kind of hesitated. She kept me home. And I slept one more night in the house. And then the next morning, she took one look at me. And she's like, that's it. We're taking you to the doctor. You know, I don't even think she had an appointment. She just put me in the car and took me. I guess she told me that I was so pale that I looked like white paint or like almost clear. She could see through me. It was that bad.
Wow.
So took me up to the doctor. He immediately knew that something serious was going on. And I remember a lot of fast talking, going back and forth between my mother and the doctor. And the doctor kept insisting I go immediately to the hospital. And Mom wanted to wait and tell my dad. She kind of really relied on him for decisions, you know. And something like an operation, she wanted him involved. But he was out of town and there was no cell phones. This happened in 1963. So they get me into the hospital. Nurses, really nice nurses, put me in a room. And I remember they started shaving my belly with shaving cream and a man's razor, which I thought was really weird because at 8 years old, I didn't have any hair on my chest. Mm-hmm. But they explained to me that there's a little bit of fuzz on your skin, so that has to go. And that's when I realized, or somebody then said something about, well, this is how we get ready for an operation. They're going to cut you open. Oh, then it hit. Something real serious is going to happen here. And I started to get scared. My mother was going back and forth in the hospital to the front office, then back to the room to check on me. Back to the front office, trying to get on the phone and call my dad somehow. What it came down to was my dad was on the road with his boss. She knew what town they're expected to go to. And I think she knew what motel they were going to check into. But she wanted to get a hold of him sooner. So she was working with a telephone operator and the operator said, you know, do you know where they might stop for a cup of coffee? You could leave a message there. Mm-hmm. And that's what she wound up doing. And that's how she finally reached my dad. So there was a message left with at a cafe for me. So dad came home as quick as he could.
But did they cut you open? Were they already start the surgery at this point or were they waiting for your dad?
No, they didn't wait for him. They couldn't.
Right. So you're going through the surgery. Is this when the near-death experience happened when you were in surgery?
Yes.
So what happened? So exactly what happened when you start to transition?
Well, the first thing is when they strapped me down to the operating table, it scared me because I was so strapped down so tight. And that little hospital in 63, they didn't have injections, you know, to knock people out. So they used ether on me. Oh, and ether's a nasty way to have to go under. So it made me really dizzy. I felt like my body was stationary and my head detached and started orbiting my body like a planet. I remember the spinning and just, you know. And then it was out. I was in blackness. And I don't know how long I was in that blackness, but I suddenly realized that I could still think and that I was still me. I was no longer in my body. I didn't know where I was. It was like somebody had locked me in a dark closet. And it was quiet, was comfortable. I felt no pain. But I got curious and I kept looking around like, what is this place? And why can't I hear anything? Why can't I see anything? And the more I struggled with all that, the more it all came back. And then eventually I did start hearing things. And then I did start seeing things. And one of the first things I saw was spirits rising up. Somehow I understood it was rising up off the earth. And it was people that were passing away on earth. And I saw like four or five different people at different times go up and then passed me. They left their bodies. They looked like they were grandparents to me with gray hair. You know, they looked old. They were very happy. They were smiling because they left their bodies. They probably weren't feeling very good when they died. And then they just kept going up and they were smiling and they're happy and zoom. And then off they went. And I remember wondering where they went. So my eyes worked well enough to see that. But then eventually I started noticing that I wasn't alone. And I started seeing like sets of eyes way off in the distance. And it was like they were behind a barrier and it was blacker than black, blacker than where I was. I took it like they were deeper into the darkness than I was. Mm-hmm. I suddenly realized that they could understand my thoughts. When you're in the spirit form, your thoughts are not private.
Right.
You can sense what they are thinking and they in return can sense yours. Well, being a little kid and being scared anyway, before I went under, I didn't know where I was. I entertained fear. And to me, those sets of eyes looked like eyes hiding in a deep forest, you know, like animals. And they started coming closer and closer. And then I got really scared. Like, when they realized I was scared, they attacked. And they could fly and I couldn't. The reason I could not fly is because I had a cord coming out of my belly, my spiritual belly, a cord that went down to my body on the operating table. I followed it, traced it. I looked down. I could see my body on the operating table. And I had the silver cord holding me there. And that's the reason why I didn't go up like those spirits that were dying on the planet, on the earth. It held me there in this darkness. So these spirits that came after me, they were angry, mean, bitter, hateful. They hated me. And they wanted to kill me. So they came after me. They attacked. They knew I was trapped and I couldn't leave. And they loved it. And the more scared I got, the more happy they got. Because they kept laughing. And they would like hit me like in a body slam and I'd be suspended by that cord. I'd just spin in circles, which didn't help. They were beating me down pretty good. And then, so I must have been right at the entrance of hell is where I was. And those spirits, they actually sounded like children. They sounded, yeah, that's not, all I can tell you is they laughed and giggled like delighted children. Mm-hmm. And so they kept attacking me and beating me up and having a great time of it. And I finally got to the point, I got so tired of it. I started asking them to leave me alone and that made it worse. They attacked me harder. And then finally somewhere from deep down inside me, I said, please God, make them stop. Then they were furious. They told me to shut up. And I wouldn't. I just kept calling out for help. And then I heard another voice. At first, it was way off in the distance. And it kept coming closer, and it was calling out to me. And somehow, I just knew I could trust this other voice. It sounded like it was concerned and it cared. You know, I heard you calling. Where are you? I'll find you. But call out again, you know, that kind of stuff. And I kept calling out, I'm down here, I'm down here. Can you hear me? Can you see me? Well, when it finally got up to me, those bad children, those bad spirits that were attacking me, they took off. They were scared now. It changed everything. Mm-hmm. And what I realized later in life, when I've had some time to analyze all of that, what came to me was an angel. And that angel glowed with light. So I could see again. Mm-hmm. And those things that attacked me could not tolerate that light. It was like it burned them. Mm-hmm. So when that angel got close, those spirits just took off. They had to hide back in the depths. So this angel, he understood I was very frightened. And he came to save me. He had he didn't have wings, but he did hover. So I think in churches and stuff, when I see pictures of angels with wings, I get the feeling that whoever is drawing it is just trying to depict that they hovered. But of course, in the early days, no human could fly. They can't mm-hmm. hover, so they had to have wings.
Of course.
So there they are. There they are. And this halo business, now you don't actually see a halo, but you can see people glowing with light. Mm-hmm. So, he just glowed. Very nice man, very pleasant looking. He had a long flowing white robe, but it was cinched around the waist with a belt, and he had a sword attached to it, a long sword. And he also had a strap over his shoulder, and it was a horn, a long horn.
Gabriel.
Yeah, well, Michael, St. Yeah. Michael, Gabriel or Michael. So we talked, and he asked me, you called out for God. And I think I asked him, why are you here? And he said, well, you called out for God, didn't you? And I go, well, yeah. But see, my concept at 8 years old wasn't very good. I didn't.
You still have an 8-year-old mind at this point.
Yes.
Yeah. You're not in your full soul yet. You still have the consciousness of an 8-year-old.
Yeah. And that consciousness stayed with me throughout my near death.
Okay.
I stayed as I experienced it as an 8-year-old. So, you know, when I recall all this that I experienced, I'm sharing with you the memory of an 8-year-old kid.
Got it.
But I do have quite a bit of detail remembered. But so I'm talking to this angel, and he mentioned God. And I said, yes, I did call out to God. And he asked me if I understood who God was. And somewhere in that conversation, I mentioned that I'd been going to church with my family, Sunday school. And then he had the ability to look into my life and pull out my history, all my past experiences. And so he pulled that out, and he was looking for proof that I'd gone to church, and he found it. And he found an incident where I was singing with a bunch of other kids in the front of the church. I was really little, and we were singing Jesus Loves Me. And it was a fun moment because I was screwing up and wasn't singing it right. And I was next to a little kid that I went to grade school with. And he just couldn't stand it that I wasn't singing it right. And he stopped me in front of the whole congregation and told me the right words. No, this is what you sang. He was correcting me. And the congregation was laughing. Oh, the old people, they got a big kick out of that. But the angel, he kind of liked it too. He was like, he liked it. He thought it was pretty good. But eventually we got serious again. And he told me that he was going to have to leave me. And then I got scared again. And he said, well, I can't leave you like this. I'll have to protect you. So he took out his sword and he cut my cord. Mm-hmm. And he put me in a plastic bubble, and it almost felt like plastic. It even kind of squeaked, but it was big. I could roll around in it. It was very comfortable. And he told me, this will take you up to where all the others went. But before he sent me up, he was talking up to others above me, he would look up and there'd be like a yellow glow light up there, and he would talk up there. And he was using a language I didn't understand. I'd never heard before. And then he gave him an answer. And then he talked to me a little bit. And I asked him, what are they saying? Or what are you doing? And he told me that they up there, whoever they is, they're looking for your family up in heaven. They're trying to figure out who you are and where you should go. And I'm like, oh, okay. I had, at that point in my life, I had no idea that I had family in heaven. My father, my mother, they'd never talked about it, losing anyone and having to go to a funeral and all that. So I knew about heaven. I'd read about it, heard about it. But anyway, so this angel, he says, well, goodbye. You're safe. Don't worry. The bubble will keep you safe. He sent me up. Eventually, I wound up floating over the earth, and I could see down below. I knew it was the earth, and I could see like lights in dark places, like streetlights, big cities, you know, kept going up. And then I saw all kinds of stars and galaxies, and I knew they were galaxies because we studied some of that in school. I realized eventually that up there in my bubble, I wasn't alone. I detected multiple channels that reached down to the earth. They were like tubes, and inside those tubes were people, and they were all traveling up like me, going up. And where the tube ended was at the opening of a tunnel, and the tunnel looked like a whirlpool, and it had bright lights stuck inside it that were spinning with it. It turns out those bright lights, they weren't stars that were inside that tunnel. Those were people like me. We all kind of glowed with a little bit of light. Mm-hmm. And then, so we get up to the tunnel. The tunnel sort of acted like a sorting device. I don't know how else to describe it. Mm-hmm. Spiritual people that go to church kind of resent my mechanical description of things, but... Mm-hmm. You know, I'm sorry, folks, this is the way it is. Mm. So the tunnel acted like a sorting device. And then people that were around me in these tubes got separated, moved over to other parts of the tunnel. And then I never saw them again. And then once I was fully inside the tunnel, I was by myself. And it kind of went up and down, around, kind of curved. So I was traveling. I felt like I was traveling a distance. And there were brilliant colors like emerald green and royal blue, and ruby red. Beautiful colors were flashing and going past me. And then at the end of the tunnel, I got spit out into open space again. It was very quiet, very dark, and there wasn't another soul around. It was just me. And I'm floating in this bubble. And I go up, the bubble kept going up, and then it came to a barrier like a puffy cloud, and then it stopped. And I sat there for a very short amount of time. Two arms reached down through the cloud, grabbed me by the shoulders, lifted me up, set me down, and then I'm standing in front of a man that I've never met before. Now, from sharing this story with my family years later, my dad told me that he thought that man was his cousin.
Okay.
And his name was Eddie, and he died in the Korean War. So I was born in 55. He would have died around 51 or 52, maybe 53. I don't know exactly when the Korean War ended. Mm-hmm. So he died in the Korean War. And so this all took place in November. Yeah, it would have been early November of 63. So he must have been dead at least 10 years. So anyway, he greets me and he starts asking me questions about who are you and do you know where you are and stuff like that. And I didn't have a clue. I was just stupid, I guess. I just didn't know where I was. I think he expected me to know how I was connected to his family. As it turns out, he was part of my dad's family. And I didn't know. So he took me up to more people. And he told me that they were, I think he said they're my mom and dad, but I think actually they were his grandparents. Because mm-hmm. I know now that when all this happened, his mom and dad were still alive. So, yeah, it must have been his grandparents. So I met my great grandparents on my dad's side.
Okay.
Both sets. Mm-hmm. And the two women, the two grandmothers in particular, paid real close attention to me and talking to me. And they couldn't figure out who I was. It was almost like I was unannounced, which is really weird because other near-death people that I've listened to, it seems like relatives come to them and they know in advance.
Sure.
But the way it was for me, my relatives really didn't know who I was. I was unexpected. So we're talking back and forth and trying to figure out who I am. And it finally came down to, well, what's your name? I said, my name is Ken. And they go, well, what's your last name? And I said, Leth. And that's when they go, oh, they knew that name. And then they were like, well, who's your father's name? And, or what's your father's name? And I said, Lyle. And then they said, well, he's our grandson. We know your father. And then it took me a while to figure out that my grandma and grandpa living on Earth at one point must have been young like me. I had no clue.
Right, because you're right.
I was 8 years old, and my dad never talked about his grandparents. I mean, they were dead long before I was born.
Gotcha.
And he just never talked about them. So I didn't even know I had an extended family going back.
So once they find out who you are, where do they take you?
Well, we talked quite a bit, and I met quite a few other relatives. Mm-hmm. It was like a party, like a celebration. Everybody was so joyful. Mm-hmm. Well, eventually, I was one of my great grandmothers came to me and said, "Someone is coming to greet you. This is someone that's very special." And she tried to prepare me. It was like, "Now be good, be nice, don't be scared. Everything's fine." You know, that kind of thing, like a grandmother would do. And this, I could see it, an entity coming for me. It was in a distance and it was a woman. And I could see her kind of traveling, but they didn't walk. They floated. And she just kind of floated and kept coming closer. And then when she's right in front of me, she's a very nice lady. And she looked older, like my grandmother's. But the very first thing I noticed was her clothing was just like a tunic. And it was made out of something like sackcloth, like a sack of potatoes would come in. Mm-hmm. It looked really like burlap sack. It was really rough and looked itchy, you know. And she greeted me and we're talking a little bit. And then I got brave, I guess. I pointed out that her hair looked weird. She had chunks of hair sticking out like somebody mm-hmm. really given her a terrible headache, or I mean, haircut. And it's just sticking out in bunches. I said something about it. And I think my great-grandmother was a little bit embarrassed. And then they started talking real fast. And then what was explained to me was this woman, who I had no idea who she was, she told me that when she lived on Earth, she didn't have scissors. Mm-hmm. And she cut her hair with a knife.
Got it.
And
got it.
That's why it looked all choppy like that. So where she probably always had a hood or something too.
So where did she take you?
She told me that my family had a long history and she wanted me to see it. So I agreed to go with her. And she had so much love in her. She treated me like a mother would treat a child. So I just call her mother because she mm-hmm. never told me who she was. Whenever I talk about her, I talk about her as mother in heaven. So she takes me away from my immediate family in heaven, and we go on this path and journey. And she transformed into, like, at one point she transformed into a light, but yet she's holding me like a mother would hold a baby. And I transformed. I was like an infant at one point, and she was just holding me and loving me. And then another time she's holding my hand and I was walking like a toddler. She's a great mother. So she again said, your family has a long history, and I would like to show you that. And she walked up to this place and she just sort of waved her arm. And there's another tunnel, another opening. Only this one looks like a cave. And this one doesn't spin and rotate. It looked more like it was stone, you know. And I noticed in the tunnel, there were people. But the tunnel went back in like layers or steps. And what it came down to was each level it going back in that cave represented a generation of people in my family. Mm. And I could see from where we were standing, I could see at least 10, 15 generations or levels going back, probably further. I believe I saw my great-great-grandparents on my dad's side. I believe I saw them. They never, see, my family's from Denmark, and they never came to America. So my family lost all contact with them. And my grandfather, he never knew them, never met them. But I got to see this older couple, and I believe they were my double great grandparents. And the woman was sitting in a chair and she's waving, smiling, trying to get my attention. But when I looked to the far back end of the cave, I saw, past all those generations, I saw one man standing alone next to a brilliant light. And he was very tall and very bent over, and he was holding a walking stick, not a cane, but a walking stick. So it went up above his head. And he was wearing, I think, a form of pants, but they were very loose looking. And he was just standing there, just absorbing the warmth coming out of that brilliant light in front of him. And he was enjoying it very much. And then Mother got my attention again. And she said, so you see that light at the end of the tunnel? And she said, that light is coming to greet you. It wants to say hello to you. So then eventually I saw the light coming through the tunnel closer and closer and closer. And then it was in front of me. And almost instantly, it transformed into a man. And he looked to be late 20s, early 30s. I do remember, I think I remember a beard. I think I remember dark hair, but it wasn't super long. Nice fellow, but I can't really, his facial features, I can't really describe them.
Sure.
So I asked Mother, well, who is this? And she just simply said, well, on earth, you might have been told that his name is Jesus. So she said, this is my son. This is Jesus. So I must have been standing there with Mother Mary. And but he was super nice, nice guy, great with kids. He knew how to talk to me on my level. He was good. I mean, he was an interesting guy. I liked him. And, but I saw him talking back and forth with Mother like a son does with their own mother, and with respect. Mm-hmm. At one point, they were discussing what to do with me. And, you know, I think if Mother had said, nah, let's not do that, let's do something else, I think he would have said, okay. You know, he would have been fine with it. He was real accommodating. I've had a religious background through my church, and I've observed other people talk about Jesus and all that. And, you know, I wish people here on earth would just knock off this business of Jesus is this ultimate powerful God. And if you ever meet him, you should just throw yourself on the ground and beg for mercy because we're nothing but worthless sinners. Mm-hmm. No, it's not the way it was at all. I think if I'd done that, he would have laughed. He would have mm-hmm. said, get up, you know, because he loved me and he was giving me love. And it was because I was treated like a member of the family, which we are. All of us are. Every single one of us. I don't care what religion you are, what nationality you are. You could be born with all kinds of defects. It doesn't matter. You could be the most beautiful person on the planet. It doesn't matter. We're all equal in the eyes of God.
So what do these two do with you?
Well, Mother told me that Jesus needed to spend some time alone with me. So he did. He took me away from her for a little bit. But it was like he was playing with me. He's going, like, he said, I have to show you something. And he made it sound like a game. And he goes, now watch this, you know, and he just, whoom, he turned into a brilliant light again. And I'm just standing there. Oh, wow. This is so cool. But what was so cool about it was his love and the light radiated through me. So when you're in the spirit form and you're in heaven, you have no need for food. You have no need for oxygen. You have a need for love because it feeds your soul. And the light that God, Jesus, radiates is like food. Mm-hmm. And it goes through you. It purifies you. It feeds you. And it builds you up. That's your food in heaven. Mm-hmm. And it is wonderful. Mm-hmm. And I expanded. He expanded and I expanded. I was like filling up the room and so was he. And yeah, it was pretty great. And then eventually he didn't say he was going to do it, but he took me to God. God.
The big man, as they say.
The big G. Yeah.
The big G, as they say.
Yeah, to the big G. And I never saw him. He too was a bright light. I actually didn't dare look directly at him because his light was so intense. But I felt that love radiating from him. But I heard his voice and he communicated with me on purpose. God did. And his voice, by the way, now I call him a man. God was a man simply because he had a deep rumbling voice like a man. Mm-hmm. And I saw no image. So my only reference is that deep voice. But his voice just rattled. And so we're talking and God says, so you've met Jesus. Do you know what he did for me? And I didn't really understand why Jesus had to die on the cross. So I think God sort of explained it to me. And then God was like, because Jesus did that for me and he sacrificed himself for me, he said, you too can make sacrifices on earth and you can earn great rewards in heaven, just like Jesus did. Mm-hmm. Well, then I got a little bit spooked and I was like thinking to myself, oh, no, he wants me to get crucified like Jesus. I don't want to do that. I got a little bit scared. But God understood. And then he was like, I'm not asking you to do that for me. You have to live your life. And he did say he was going to send me back to earth. But he said, when you make sacrifices and you do it for others, you take care of others, you care about others, then when you earn rewards in heaven for being a loving person, somebody who takes care of others.
It seems like you're getting this information like a child would get this information. It's really broken down like a child, like lessons a child would be listening to. This is not a complex conversation. And I have to ask you, though, mm-hmm. you know, there's been so many, I mean, obviously there's been thousands of religions and philosophies throughout history. From what I hear from other near-death experiencers, if you're a Buddhist, you know, you go down that road. If you're Hindu, you know, there's certain things you see. Do you believe that you were introduced with these iconic images of Catholic or Christianity because that's what you were raised with?
I think so. They knew that about me. They knew I had a background in religion. And so I think they wanted to present things to me in a way that they thought I could understand.
Right. So in other words, Buddha's not going to show up and you're going to go, who is this guy? I've never heard of him.
Oh, yeah. I would know nothing about Buddha at that age.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. Okay. So that's an interesting point to make. So they decided to send you back at this point?
Well, it didn't happen right away. When I was done with God, Mother took me back, and then Jesus was there again. Oh, wow. That Mother gave me like a tour of heaven. But first I had to go through my my life review. Mm-hmm. And that's where I saw my own birth. Mm-hmm. And all my life, it always stuck with me. I saw this old doctor swatting me on the bottom when I was born because I wouldn't breathe. And the reason was I wouldn't breathe is because I felt fine. I was out of my body right after I was born because I was like half dead and my spirit was floating around and I felt fine. I was comfortable. I didn't care if my body was going to die, but he kept swatting me to draw me into my body, or at least that's what it did. Mm-hmm. But I remember this old man swatting this baby and I'm like, wow, that's a little bit rough. I remember thinking that. So
you see your life review.
I saw my life review. I saw many incidents throughout my life that I'm only 8 years old, but I saw some really cool times, you know, playing with family and stuff.
Sure.
And lots of fun. Then Mother took me on. Jesus came back for a little bit, and then he took me through like another barrier. And he told me, you can go through this barrier by yourself. It was almost like a door. And he said, you can go through here by yourself. You're safe. You'll be fine. Just go through here and explore for a while. I think they were just trying to use up a little bit of time, maybe, the way it felt.
Negative. They're things getting set up. Like, we need a few more minutes before we can put the show on. Can we put them in this room?
It did kind of feel that way. It was like they were babysitting me all this time. My body's being operated on down on Earth. And so, they just set me loose. And what it was like infinite wisdom, knowledge. Mm-hmm. And it was floating around in open space. I was exposed to tremendously beautiful music. I saw equations, mathematical equations, kind of floating through the air. And, well, there's no air up there, but I could see them floating around.
Space, yeah.
Space. And I could see these equations, and I understood them at that time. I do remember zeroing in on the relationship that humanity has with living organisms like plants. Mm. And that there's a cooperation between humanity and plants. Many people don't understand that relationship, but we have an ability to make things grow. Mm-hmm. And we can do it through our energy and our love. And we wouldn't have to rely so much on pesticides and things like that if we had a better handle on how we can cooperate with plants and make them grow. So I saw all that. But the coolest thing I saw, see, I'm really into music. I have a stereo that's way too expensive, but so what? Mm-hmm. I love it. And I heard music. But it was more like vibrations. It was almost like heaven is a mechanical structure. So if you can imagine a very large, large building made out of like steel, so big that sometimes the weight shifts and it groans, that's what it sounded like up there. So there were times when heaven vibrated and it'd be deep. It'd be like really deep. And then there are other times it squeaked like chirping birds, but I could see the vibrations. It'd be like there'd be a barrier or a wall next to me. And when the vibrations hit it, I could see the vibrations going up that wall, and then they changed colors.
Mm.
God's voice was the deepest vibration of all, that rumbling deepness. So I saw all that going on, and then eventually I was called back. I think it was Mother who called me back to the doorway. And then she kind of gave me a tour of heaven. She took me to a place where she showed me a choir, and it was almost like the Mormon tabernacle, because I was standing in the middle, and they were like bleachers on either side, and it was full of singers. I think it was mostly women. But I heard them singing like classical music, and it was the most beautiful music I ever heard. And it got to a point where I could almost, in my mind, I could choose the next note and they would sing it. So I was composing this music with them and they were singing it. Wow, was it beautiful. And then at another point, I was given some education. I was shown the image of a Bible. And as the pages were flipping, I heard a voice, and I don't know whose voice it was, but I heard this voice explaining to me what was happening in all these stories.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure what I remember out of all that is at the get-go, Adam and Eve, the original sin, humanity is automatically sinful forever because of what Eve did.
Right.
No, that has nothing to do with it. We're not being punished. God didn't send us down here to punish us. He sent us down here because humanity had a desire to experience free will and to find out for ourselves how to gain knowledge. And God went along with it. It is not a punishment. It may not have been the wisest choice that humanity made, but we're living it. And if we're going to be calling it a punishment, then darn it, we're punishing each other.
Right.
God isn't doing it to us. So when we go up to heaven, the door is open and we're greeted like a lost child that they hadn't seen forever. And they want us back. They're glad to have us back.
So you're getting this tour. And I remember somewhere along the lines that in some other interviews you've done that you talk about, you were privy to what's happening in history. You were able to see some stuff in history, and you were able to see some things that were going to come down the future.
If you'd like to talk about it.
Yeah, I would love to. I'd love to.
Okay. Because a lot of that is happening right now.
Right.
So Mother eventually took me to, it felt like a room, but it was very big. And in this room, I saw some entities standing around. It was kind of like a machine, but it was a model of the earth, and it was very big. And this earth was like up on a pedestal, and it rotated just like the earth would. And I could sort of remember underneath part of the pedestal was like there was some controls, like buttons or something. And these entities were maintaining it. So I was curious, and I asked, what is this thing? And I was told that it was like a time capsule. So all past events on Earth that humanity experiences are kept there. But also that I can see the future. So at first I was curious about the past, and they showed me something because I wasn't specific about what I wanted to see. So they showed me a really old city. It might have been Rome, or it might have gone back further, because I remember donkeys and carts and like a parade through town. And I lost interest in it pretty quick. So then I decided, well, I'd rather see the future. So I walked up to these entities that were maintaining it. And one of them was like a teacher. And Mother handed me off to her and told me, just work with her, and she'll tell you everything you need to know. And she did. She talked like a teacher. She was like very businesslike and down to earth. And she gave me very direct questions or answers. And once she told me something, she expected me to understand it. She got a little bit impatient with me if I didn't. But I came to her and I said, well, I'm interested in the future, but I said, where do I fit into all this? Can you show me where my time is on Earth? And she goes, oh, yeah, I can show you that. She pointed down on the planet where I was born, which is central Nebraska. Mm-hmm. She pointed to it. And as soon as she did, she goes, here it is. Instantly, a vision opened up in front of me like a screen. And I could see things going on down on Earth in my time frame. Mm-hmm. And then she goes, she said, if you go back down to Earth, this is some of what you will see. This is what you'll experience in your life. So the very first thing I saw, I was like standing on grass next to a street, and there was a row of cars driving through the city, paved roads, nice big cars. And somehow I understood that this was a procession. And in that car was the president of the United States.
Mm-hmm. Kennedy.
And then all of a sudden, something happened. People were crying and they were upset and the car sped off. I didn't see the blood and the gore, but I knew it was the president. And I was shocked. See, I was in the hospital. This happened. My near death happened about a week before he was shot.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So when they sent me back to Earth and I was sick and I was in the hospital, I didn't remember anything about it. But I remember arguing with the entity, the teacher entity. I was like, I liked Kennedy. See, I was only 8, but I knew that my parents really liked him. JFK, they liked him. And so I saw that he was hurt, and I was asking, why would God let this happen? If you know this is going to happen in advance, why can't you stop it? Why won't you stop it? That kind of stuff. And I was pretty much told, they can't interfere. We can't interfere, they said. And the reason was, humanity makes choices out of their hands. Humanity makes choices that sometimes lead to terrible things like this, and they just have to let it go. Humanity has chosen this path, and they have to let it go. I wasn't real comfortable with the explanation, but what can I do? Mm-hmm. You know, I was in their hands.
Can't really complain.
So from there...
Really complain. There's no complaint department.
What are they going to?
Customer service. Yeah, you can go to.
That's right. I'm going to take my ball and go home now. All right. Can't do that. So, and then they told me, they sped it up, and then they told me that actually there's some important things that are going to happen in your life that you're going to witness, and so they decided to speed it up and to go, and then I was told that these things that you're going to see, you're going to happen later in your life. But I saw them speeding it up. I saw things jumping around on the screen, and I saw, wow, I saw wars. I saw people marching in the streets. I saw love and good things too. But it just all just went blah, 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 real fast. And then all of a sudden it slowed down. And then I saw an image of the Supreme Court building. And it's a unique building because of the facade, the front, and the pillars in front. And the facade is elevated just a little bit. And I was told this is a government building in the United States. And toward the end of your life, or later in your life, some things are going to happen. And there's some things that are going to happen through this building that are disruptive, that cause some turmoil in your country. They never told me what exactly that would be, but they said it'll all start with this building and what's happening there. So I went public with my story in 2014, 2015 through a group called NDERF. I don't know if you're familiar, mm-hmm. but that's my first time that I went public. And at in 2015, they ruled that gay marriage was legal. Mm-hmm. And then I saw all the disruption coming out of evangelical churches and politicians raising a big stink about it. Then there was that county clerk that was going to get thrown in jail, and they were protesting, and they were really offended by the whole thing. I saw that as the beginning of the turmoil. So I'm sticking with it. I've had people tell me that maybe it was the ruling on abortion. No, the beginning was the ruling on gay marriage. Mm-hmm. That's the way I took it. Because things really have snowballed since then. Mm-hmm. So then from the Supreme Court building, then it jumped. And I saw all kinds of storms and stuff hitting the East Coast of the country. And since about, in early 90s or maybe it was the late 80s, Andrew, was a terrible hurricane.
I was in it.
Were you? Mm-hmm. Well, we were, oh, wow.
Yeah, I was in Fort Lauderdale. I wasn't in Miami. I was in Fort Lauderdale at the time, and I felt it. And a tree fell on our roof. I mean, we laid on the roof, thank God, and break through, but we had some damage, and it was terrifying. My grandfather slept through the whole thing. He was snoring. Because, you know, it's grandpa. But it was pretty terrifying. Yeah, he wake up in the morning. He's like, is it over?
Wow. What a cool old man. I would have loved it.
He's seen some stuff. So, yeah, no, I've been in a few hurricanes in my life.
Well, there's been an increase of bad storms starting back, I guess, in the late 80s, whatever, moving on up. And around, I think it seems like 2009, 2012, there were even more.
It's starting growing every year. Every year it's gotten worse.
Every year it's getting worse. And I saw that. I saw more and more storms coming to the United States. And then I saw lots of people, pockets of people dying, like in cities. Concentrations of people dying. When I first described this a long time ago, I assumed it was because of storms. Mm-hmm. But now COVID has hit, and there were pockets of people in cities close to each other all dying. So I wonder if maybe it wasn't COVID, but I just didn't understand that it was sickness. Mm-hmm. Then it skipped, and then it then I saw Hillary Clinton campaigning for the presidency in 2016. I heard her voice. She had a campaign voice that as soon as she was on TV and I heard it, I knew. Mm-hmm. I had seen this in advance. And I remember being a little bit surprised that a woman was running for president, because in 63, nobody would ever consider something like that. Mm-hmm. But I asked the teacher entity, I asked her, you know, something like, well, she sounds all right. I was told that this woman campaigning for the presidency would be there with another president. Mm-hmm. Like, she was important. And sure enough, Bill was on the campaign trail with her all the time.
Of course.
So it must have been Bill. I remember telling the entity, I was like, well, she sounds all right. I don't think she would be a bad president or something like that. I was told, yeah, but she may not be allowed to serve. She may not win. And it was explained that there were laws that might interfere. And that's all I was really told. Mm-hmm. But they did not tell me anything bad about her whatsoever. Like, if she had won, they would have been fine with it. And if Hillary ever hears one of my sessions, I hope she hears me say that. She's okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So then from there, it skipped again. And then I was shown this very angry, disruptive man in our government. I don't recall his face. All I can recall is his personality was just nasty, always unhappy. Never satisfied, always complaining, wanting more, 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 expecting it to be handed to him, chewing people out all the time. And he had blonde hair. Mm-hmm. Then, because of this man, I saw demonstrations in the streets and people fighting and arguing, lots of disruption in our country. And I remember feeling really disgusted by the whole thing because this man was the source of it all. That's the way I took it. Mm-hmm. Anyway. And I remember asking the teacher entity, you know, where did this guy come from? This is ridiculous. Why is he our president? And she showed me a vision, and it was like I saw a vision of the Bible again. Bible opened up, and it was like flow charts were going around through the pages. Pages would flip, the bar graph would change. And what I was told was, this is the progression of human history from the beginning. And it went very fast, just zip, 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 zip. And then it slowed down, and then it stopped. And then like an arrow jumped out of the Bible and landed in old Europe. And then the vision took me there. And I saw people in Europe building churches, but it was like the Middle Ages, early Christian churches. And I saw them building cathedrals and, you know, big, big structures. Then I was told that these people would establish their churches, establish their rules, their beliefs, that they would bring them with them, and they would immigrate to the United States. I actually saw them getting on ships and sailing to the U.S. Then another arrow jumped out of the Bible, and it landed in the deep south of the U.S., like around Georgia, Arkansas, Louisiana, down in there, Mississippi, the deep south, landed down in there. And then I was told this man would become president because of churches that came from Europe over here to the United States. And they supported this man and helped get him elected. And then I saw these churches in America growing, big structures, big complexes, schools, fancy mansions that people were living in, lots of money being exchanged. And I saw them involved in politics. And I was told point blank, stay away from these people. Stay away from these churches. They are evil and they are harmful and they will do you no good. And I was like, all right. And so I never have had anything to do with them. I never listened to them. I mean, you know, in the early 80s, with the advent of cable TV, that's when televangelism started, and they started with their Starlinks or whatever they call themselves, Godlink, you know, with their satellites, and they're broadcasting all their stuff on TV. Well, when cable TV first came out, you could accidentally come across one of their channels and listen to them moan and groan about what God needs. But it always was, God needs your money.
To buy me a new plane.
Yeah, a new plane. Yeah, because I can't stand to be in a commercial plane. That's a tube of demons. Oh, please. But yeah, I was shown just how evil and backwards these people were and how far away from true religion they were. It's a business they have. It's not a church. It's a business. Mm-hmm. And so they use their money to influence politics. And of course, the politicians will take that money gladly and do as the money givers ask. So yeah, that's how Donald Trump got elected, partly from them. And so, but then I saw a lot more demonstrations in the streets. And then I saw one really bad demonstration. I mean, people were getting hurt bad. And I do know the location was south of New York City. Now, at first I thought it was Charlottesville, But because of the destructiveness, I think what I was shown was the insurrection. Mm-hmm. Took place in Washington, D.C. is basically south of New York.
Sure.
So I saw that. Then I saw this angry president. I saw him in the Oval Office in the White House, and he looked really kind of spooked and a little bit scared. And he was walking back and forth, not knowing what was going to happen next. He was very unsure of himself, and he kept going out into the hallway expecting visitors, and they weren't coming, and they finally showed up. And he didn't like what they had to tell him. He got very upset. And then they took him out of the White House, out into the lawn, and they left him there. And then the next vision jumped, and he's holding a rally on the steps of, close to the steps of a large building in Washington, D.C. He's behind a microphone, and he's telling people to fight, fight, fight. And he's shaking his fist. And Donald Trump did exactly that. Mm-hmm. The day of the insurrection. And then from there, I just saw a lot of chaos, a lot of fighting, a lot of disruption in the country, people arguing and not agreeing with anything. I did see at one point, I saw like in our government, I saw like a panel of people discussing him. And I'm not so sure that now that the January 6th committee has been formed, I'm not so sure I wasn't shown them. But when I first started talking about this, there was a lot of talk of impeaching Donald. Oh, yeah. Well, he's been impeached and twice. So a couple of years back when I was interviewed, I said he will be impeached. And sure enough, he was twice. So, so I saw the disruption. And then I saw Donald at a rally somewhere close, not too far away from Washington, D.C. It was kind of like the upper northeast, up in there somewhere. I saw him at a rally, getting people riled up again. But not too long after the rally, it was like he suddenly clutched his heart like he'd been hurt. And he couldn't breathe, and he looked scared. And then I saw him sort of get sucked into a spiral, like a tunnel. The same kind of spiral that I went through when I died on the table. He got sucked into it. And I saw him spinning inside that tunnel, and then he got sucked in and he disappeared. The very next thing I saw, he was in a hospital room, surrounded by, I think, his family. And I pretty much understood that he was dying. He didn't have long to live.
He had a heart attack?
Heart attack, or maybe he was shot. Mm. I don't know. But that's the next thing that I expect to happen very, very soon. Every time I see a picture of him, not all made up with his orange goop and in a suit and everything, God, he looks awful. Mm. Pale and yuck. So I expect something to happen to him any day now. So he's still holding rallies.
Yeah. And then you talked, I think you spoke about something about a complete either civil war or war within the United States, something, you know, like things happening.
So after he passes away, then I saw a major increase in fighting and destruction in the streets. And I saw a group of people acting very covert, go into a tower-like building, kind of like a small skyrise. It turns out to be a TV studio is what it looked like. And people, my wife is home. So people are inside this place, and there's an explosion. And I saw, like, it looked like a TV studio with cables and lights hanging, and they're all burned and broken. And then I asked, Why were people attacking this building? Why were they demonstrating around it? Because they were very angry. And I was told, because they believe lies. They're being told lies on purpose, and they believe them. And So I asked, what is this place? And it was explained to me like it was a place where information is shared. So it could have been like a TV studio, or it could have been like connected to the internet. Mm. So that happens. And then after that, there's a period where there's like an investigation. And I saw two men, probably in their 30s, maybe. One has darker hair. One had lighter hair, tied to money with a real flippant attitude. And they're being interviewed and talked to because of that explosion. And they were being asked what they knew about it, why, who was involved, and why did it happen? And the one with the darker hair laughed it off like, he didn't care. So this is the way it is. Mm-hmm. You know, what's the government expect? Boy, that sure sounded to me like Junior, Don Junior. Mm-hmm. Or it could have been Shapiro. Mm-hmm. Could have been that black-haired kid, Shapiro. Because mm-hmm. I remember hearing a laugh, and it was hideous. And I've never heard Junior laugh, but I've heard Shapiro laugh, and it was pretty bad. Mm-hmm. So it could have been Shapiro. I don't know. I can't say for sure. I can't see Shapiro as being any kind of a leader. Not really. But for that matter, Don Jr., I can't imagine him a leader either. But they were presented to me as if they were leaders. And that's why they were being interviewed by the government. and then after that, things just got crazy. I saw people being pulled out of their homes in the middle of the night, like in raids, and arrested. I saw violence. I saw people killing each other. It was almost like the beginning of a civil war. Then I saw an army being built, and it looked like it came out of the West, like California. And that's where it organized. And they marched across the United States, but they organized about where I'm living, like through Nebraska, because we're just west of the Mississippi here. And the Mississippi was important. And so they organized before they crossed the Mississippi. And then fighting just over the top. Blood, destruction, people fighting. But at the same time, some of what I saw almost looked like an earthquake. Because I saw buildings shaking and toppling. I saw flooding happening. I saw a major flood hit somewhere like close to Omaha, mm-hmm. between Omaha and Iowa. I saw people dying instantly. The water came from nowhere. They're totally caught off guard. So the only way I can picture that happening is because of earthquake.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, if there's a tidal wave that hits Omaha, we're screwed. That the world has gone down if there's a tidal wave that comes in that hits Omaha.
Yeah. So I'm thinking maybe it's big enough that the Great Lakes, one of them drains, maybe.
Something like that, maybe, yeah.
Something like that. Or maybe the Missouri River backs up.
That's where the water's coming from. Got it. The
Missouri River is really big, deep. So, yeah, I wasn't shown anything about that. I'm just supposing when I say that. But no, but what I did see was multiple spirits of people jumping out of their bodies, screaming, terrified, because they're overwhelmed by water, totally caught off guard by surprise, mm-hmm. and jumping out of their bodies, instantly dying. And that wasn't a very pleasant thing. So during the worst of it, when it got really, really bad, my 8-year-old mind, my consciousness, it was overwhelming. And I turned away at one point. I couldn't watch it. Mm-hmm. It was just too much. But eventually, I did look back, as you know, the teacher entity told me to. So I looked back, and one of the next things I saw was the fighting started to die down. But I saw a concentration of people fighting around a building. Now, I'm guessing, location-wise, it could have been Arkansas. I don't know my states down there so well. It could have been Arkansas. It could have been Louisiana. Mm-hmm. Could have been Mississippi. It was a state that I believe borders the Gulf, mm-hmm. of Mexico. And I saw a building that looked fortified, but it looked like it was one level. It wasn't a sky rise. It looked like it was one level. A lot of people inside. It was big and it looked strong, like it was stone, like it could have been a government building. And I saw people marching around that building, covert. There was fighting going on and gunshots and people dying. Finally, the army gets inside that building and kills everyone in there. And then after that, the fighting dies down. But what struck me, it went down to my core, was when that building is destroyed or everyone inside is killed, I saw something like a demon rise up out of that building. And it didn't really have a human form, although it had a face, but it was big. It was like a balloon. It was like a blob and it was black. And it didn't care that everybody died. It wanted them to die. It wanted the destruction. It was the source of all the anger. It rose up and it had to leave because its job was done. And it was happy with itself. It rose up and left and it laughed, laughing all the way. But you know, as soon as it was gone, the fighting stopped and it died down. And then people were like, well, why are we fighting? Why did we do all that? And then I also remember hearing some people say, why did we believe all these wrong things that made us so angry? It made us kill each other. Why did we do that? Because mm-hmm. they were looking around and they were looking at all the destruction. It was like they were in a trance when they were fighting. Mm-hmm. They weren't in control. But once that black thing left, then their eyes were opened up and they were like, we don't want to fight. That's what it was like. I even saw one young man feeling a lot of remorse, and he was sitting alone next to a building that was completely destroyed. I mean, there were like, well, there were a few pillars and there were a couple walls left standing, but
right.
The building was wasted. And I remember hearing his thoughts. And he was like, why did we believe all that crap? Why was it so easy for them to fool us? And then why did we follow it? And why did we kill so many people? Mm. So many people died and they didn't have to. I remember feeling that remorse coming out of him. Then after that, I saw things get a little bit better. The country started to rebuild and reorganize. And there was a strong sense of, our government had been taken advantage of, and that's why the fighting happened. Or it was like our government was structured in a way that it could be taken advantage of, and that was going to have to change. Our government was going to have to be restructured, but it'd be for the better.
I mean, you could see it now. I mean, it's being tested. It's being tested all the time over the last, 6 years or so. It's things that you and I would have never even thought of.
Unless you have a really devious mind,
right? These are institutions. These are things that just you never think about any of this kind of stuff.
I think the responsible parties are nothing but think tanks, and they sit there and work out ways to disrupt our government, and they're doing it on purpose. Mm. And there's money behind it all.
So is there anything positive, sir, out of this this future? I mean, it's pretty doom and gloom here, sir.
Yes, it is. Well, okay, just a little bit more. Bear with me. So I saw some building going on and the country getting better, and it was a positive time of rebuilding. I saw that, and everybody was starting to feel like the future was bright again. But then I saw some more disruption enter the picture. But it wasn't internal in our country. It seemed like it was external from the world, other countries. And then I saw some fighting start up again. And then I saw a major explosion happen somewhere around, it looked like Yellowstone, where it's located. It looked like an atomic bomb, and it was huge. And there was a ring of white that came out of that explosion that stayed close to the ground and expanded, completely covered the continent. And then I'm floating there in the air with this entity, and she's showing me this going on. And I understood perfectly that it wiped out most human life. It was gone. It just wiped it out. And then I saw our country became real quiet and peaceful. So there were animals again, and I saw trees growing, and it became very beautiful. Eventually, the teacher entity took me to a place, and it looked like it was the Georgia coast, close to the ocean, Atlantic Ocean. And I saw a tribe of people living there, and they were like indigenous people. They wore very simple clothing, but they were full of love. They were very spiritual, very happy. And a very strange thing that I got out of it was, you and I, our generations, our pots and pans, our prized possessions. These indigenous people, when they discovered a pot or pan that was usable, they loved it, and they used them. Yeah, it was like, but they were so full of love, and they were getting along with each other very well. But they seemed to have enhanced spiritual power, like they could heal each other. Mm. And they were causing plants to grow. Mm. So they never went hungry.
How many years ahead of it is this, you think?
Oh, I can only guess, but well, once an atomic bomb has been dropped, I don't think the ground is livable for quite a while.
Hiroshima taught us that.
Yeah, so I wasn't giving any time reference. I was just shown that life is wiped out.
In the area that the bomb drops, or in the area of the continent?
It felt like almost all the continent was dead, is what it felt like.
Mm. Okay.
But I only saw the one explosion.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Oh, and another thing. I saw, as the explosion was going up into a big mushroom cloud, I saw something that looked like an angel floating over the continent. And it was gathering up souls, and it was directing them up to heaven. It was helping them rise up. I saw that. It's a very vague image, but I do remember seeing that.
Okay.
So the teacher entity, after she showed me these loving people living close to the coast, she said, so you see, Ken, there's going to be a lot of disruption coming, a lot of bad, evil things that mankind has caused on their own. It's going to have to be worked through, and you're going to see some really bad stuff. But what you have to know is, in the end, things are going to get much better. And mankind is going to be more in line with the teachings of God and living the way, through love, the way we're supposed to live. We've got a lot of habits and practices that we've adopted over the centuries that nobody challenges that.
Right. And that's absolutely things that are kind of just legacy of the old. I mean, look, we could have had electric cars in 2000. Yeah. I mean, we could have switched over from fossil fuels a long time ago. We have the technology to do so, but you know, financial interests have said no. And I get it.
In the name of making a profit.
I understand. I understand. There's a reason why a McDonald's burger is cheaper than a piece of broccoli. Like, I mean, it's just, there's, it's not that we can't do things, is that we choose not to. And it takes, it's like a big ship. I look at society as like this giant aircraft carrier that takes forever to turn. It's slow. It's not a speedboat that can just jump all over the place. It just takes for long to move. And you, I mean, even in the last 20 years, I've seen it shift. I mean, from, you know, now we all got on board. We're like, you know, I think electric is going to be where we're going to go. And we got to find some other fuel sources to become energy independent, just on a political standpoint, to have freedom from, you know, why are we buying oil from countries that want to kill us? Like, it's like, there's some logic there, and there's more spirituality. There's more understanding of spirituality. There is an awakening happening, but there's a lot of disruption as well. So it's just like it's kind of like growing pains in many ways.
It is, exactly. And the way it was shown to me, it was like, what's happening here, it was like predestined, and humanity chose this path, and it's not going to change until we change.
Right.
So the path we're on, I mean, when you think about, well, I watched the news broadcast about the Ukraine war, for example. And it's like how some of the people on TV are like analyzing the effectiveness of this type of advance, you know, that kind of thing. It's almost like a football game. Mm-hmm. They're encroaching on the enemy's territory, and what next? You know, and it's
but deadly.
People, it's very deadly. Mm-hmm. And unnecessary.
Completely.
Because that strange, weird guy in Russia has an ego problem that he can't shake. Oh, my God.
I mean, Ken, thank you for sharing this journey with me. Well, wait. So you've seen all of this, and then you get sent back into your body, right?
Right. Eventually, Mother came back and got me. Took me away from all that and took me back to my immediate family. And I believe that was like at the opening of heaven. And I was told I had to make a decision if I was going to stay up there with them or I was going to come back. But I decided to come back because I was told that my mother on earth was praying for me and that she'd be very sad if I stayed. So I decided to come back. But one other thing I need to tell you, though, is right after I was shown all those visions of the future, Mother took me aside and she said something about, if you go back with all this knowledge, if you go back to Earth with all this in your head, she said, I do not want you to be a child prophet. And she said, child prophet. Because she said, if you remember all this when you're a child and you talk about it, your life is going to be very difficult. She decided to protect me. So she sort of reached into my consciousness and she smoothed over a whole bunch of that future stuff and just wiped it out. I didn't remember it until I was in my early 20s. I woke up in a real intense dream and God spoke to me in my dream and woke me up. And then after that, it just opened my eyes. It just opened up all those old memories. And then I remembered all kinds of detail about my near death. It all came back. Mm-hmm. So throughout my childhood, I never talked about war and destruction and all that because I didn't remember it.
Right.
And I was just as surprised as everyone else when I found out that JFK died because I didn't remember that either.
Right.
So...
So then you get sent back down and then you live your life and you're here with us now sharing your knowledge. Well, I go ahead.
I have to tell you that in 2015, when the election was getting more intense, mm-hmm. I mean, the 2016 election was coming and I knew that Trump was running. I knew that Hillary was running. I was like beside myself for a while. Because I could feel the intensity of the country. I was familiar with it. I was shown all that when I was in heaven. And it was a reminder of all that stuff. And I knew some really bad things were just coming any minute. And I went on an interview with a guy called Lee Whitting. He works through IANDS. And he's got a radio broadcast. He was the very first person to interview me. Mm-hmm. And in 2015, he interviewed me and I told him about all this future stuff. What he didn't realize that day was it was so intense. I felt like I had to warn humanity we're about to make the wrong turn. And I didn't want that to happen. and I'm rattling all this stuff off about these people are wrong and those people are wrong and this is going to happen next and we need to avoid it. And, oh, you know, look out. And Lee, at the end of the interview, was kind of like, now, Ken, he goes, where's all the love? He goes, usually when I interview people, there's love. But where's all your love? And he kind of caught me off guard. I'm like, I was trying to warn people. I had to get it out. I only had an hour, you know.
But, so let me ask you one last question. I want to ask you, as far as the economy and things like that, what happens during all this time? Do we lose the dollar? Do we go back to gold coins? Do we what did you get any information about that?
No, I didn't. All I saw and all I felt was the anguish and the disruption that people, I felt their emotional reaction to everything is what I felt. Uh-huh. And then every so often I would see a particular figure like Donald who was making it worse.
Well, Ken, I'm going to ask you a few questions, ask all of my guests. What is your definition of living a good life?
Living a good life is being an open, honest person where you don't take yourself too seriously and you're empathetic and you're open to the feelings of other people and you want to help them if you can. And you leave yourself open to love.
What is your mission in this life?
My mission? At this point in my life, I just want to get along with people. I live in isolation in Nebraska, way out in the country, and I love it. My mission, I'm not so much into warning people anymore because everything's in motion. I can't stop it now. However, if it comes down to fighting a war, do you people really want to do that? I mean, come on. Do you want to tear your country apart to that point? I don't think so. And I don't think we should do it. But I don't think anybody's going to listen to me. I'm not taken serious because I'm a spiritual guy that claims that he went to heaven and met God.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
Well, there's a lot of people in churches that tell you what God wants too, and it has nothing to do with preventing a war. It has everything to do with tithing and get on the floor and grovel because you don't deserve a damn thing, you sinner. Ach, what a waste of time all that is.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Since I was shown that I have a long history in my family, the growth of the family, I believe, is very important. Mm. And so to contribute to your family by living and being fruitful and extending those generations, because I saw that guy at the end of the tunnel absorbing all that light. I believe each new generation that came after him elevated him closer to that light. So live and be fruitful. Grow your families. If you don't want to get married, that's fine. I saw single people up there too. Mm-hmm. Live your life and grow. And be good as best as you can. And then when you die and you go up to heaven, the rest of your family gets elevated one step closer to God. And so be responsible and think about your contribution to your family. And then wrap your love and appreciation for them in your good memories about them, the laughter, the love, and the comfort you felt with them, the good deeds they did for you when they made you feel good. Remember them and think about it, because I think those positive thoughts get through like a prayer, and I think it honors them up in heaven.
Ken, I appreciate your time and thank you for sharing your story with us, and hopefully it'll do some good for the world. Let's hope and pray. I appreciate you,
yes,
my friend.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, I appreciate you too. Thanks, Alex.